Hello and welcome to the topic, Existential Philosophy of Jean-Paul Sartre. It is impossible to give a small introduction to Jean-Paul Sartre. He was a multifaceted intellectual. He was known as a playwright, novelist, political commentator, literary critic, and above all, as a very influential existential philosopher. He was also known as a Marxist thinker of some repute. His influence on the French cultural sphere during his lifetime and after was unachievable by any other intellectual in the history of France. He was also some sort of a controversial figure during with a very unique view on many of the contemporary issues. He courted controversy by refusing to accept the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1964. If there is one point that he insisting on, that is the human freedom, which is at the center of his philosophy. Jean-Paul Sartre was born in a family of intellectuals and academicians. He was born at Paris in 1905. His parents were Jean-Baptiste Sartre and Anne-Marie Schweitzer. After the death of his father at a tender age, he spent most of his childhood with his maternal grandfather, who was a professor of German. It was his maternal grandfather who inculcated an interest in classical literature in little Jean-Paul. After schooling, he went on to do his higher studies at the École Normale from 1924 until 1928. After obtaining a PhD, what is usually termed as aggregation in French, in philosophy, he taught philosophy at Lycée in Le Havre, Lyon, and then Paris. It was around this time he met Simone de Beauvoir, who later became his lifelong associate and companion. Beauvoir was a feminist thinker, existentialist philosopher, and a novelist. From 1933 until 1935, Sartre was a research student first at Berlin and then at the University of Freiburg, after which he taught in the Lycée Condorcet at Paris. In 1939, he joined the French army and was captured in 1940. Released in 1941, he returned to teaching philosophy and was also an active participant in the resistance movement. Sartre has never occupied a university chair. Sartre started writing before the war. In 1936, he published an essay on the ego or self and a work on the imagination, a psychological critique. While in 1938, he published his famous novel, No Sea. Then on, he continued publishing several plays, novels, and philosophical works. It has been well documented that he was initiated to philosophy after reading Henri Bergson's essay, Time and Free Will, an essay on the immediate data of consciousness. He was soon to be introduced to other masters of Western philosophy. It has been noted that in his analytical style, Sartre has been greatly influenced by Descartes. Sartre himself has acknowledged the fact that Descartes has been a major influence over the French intellectual scene for over three centuries. He has also been strongly influenced by the German philosophers Hegel, Husserl, and Heidegger. Sartre's thought has developed partly through reflection on the methods and ideas of Descartes, Hegel, Husserl, and Heidegger. However, the foremost influence has been that of Descartes. With the German philosophers, his approach has been that of love-hate relationship. However, we do not find any influence of the British empiricism in his field of vision. The last major influence should have been materialism. Though he is a proclaimed Marxist, he was never interested in the non-Marxist forms of materialism. Perhaps the most important contribution Sartre has made to existentialism could be that he took the traditional existential themes and injected a renewed emphasis upon the meaning and importance of human freedom. And his legacy is in making existentialism accessible to all people to whom it was supposedly relevant. One of the ways he did this was through the continual dialogue he engaged in with other important movements, including Christianity and Marxism. As was suggested earlier, Sartre was a huge public figure and he got involved in politics, the arts and literature. Although he said he later regretted it, he also wrote the ultimate summary of the existential position, Existentialism is a Humanism, which is a short essay that attempts to explain the philosophy in non-technical terms to his critics and the public at large. However, he is not, of course, the creator of a system such as that of Spinoza, a system formed on a mathematical model. At the same time, his existentialist philosophy can be seen as the systematic development of certain basic ideas. It is certainly not a mere juxtaposition of impressionistic views. Sartre's writings and major ideas. It would be easy to see clear divisions in Sartre's writing career. If the first part of his career was dedicated to the existentialist philosophy, the second part was mostly dedicated to political interventions. Throughout his long writing career, although he had written philosophical articles, much of his later work was directed at easy readers. He has also been producing literary pieces all through his career. However, we see definite trails of an anarchist in the later works. Sartre's analysis of the self-conscious subject and discussion of being could be found in Being and Nothingness. Consciousness is, for Sartre, consciousness of something, something other than itself, and in this sense, transcendent. The transcendent object appears to or for consciousness, and it can thus be described as a phenomenon. However, it would be a mistake to interpret this description as meaning that the phenomenal object is the appearance of an underlying reality or essence which does not appear. He says that the phenomenal being manifests itself, it manifests its essence as well as its existence. A chair and a table would not mean anything else but themselves. If it has to be understood as something else, we need human thought to do so. A chair is something that we usually use to sit, but we can also use it occasionally to stand on. We had also seen it used as weapons in films. And if a wooden chair breaks, it later becomes firewood as well. Hence, it is us who give a chair its meaning. It is our consciousness which gives any phenomenal object a certain meaning or significance. So, any phenomenal object acquires a certain meaning or the other in relation to consciousness. Hence, if there is no consciousness to associate with, the whole world would be left with being in itself. According to Sartre, this being in itself is simply there. It is without reason, without cause, and without necessity. The concept of the in itself is one of the two key concepts of being and nothingness. The other key concept is that of consciousness, the for itself. Most of the work is devoted to this second theme. Being in itself is opaque, massive, self-identical. Hence, there is little that can be said about this. As an existentialist, Sartre is more interested in man and the human reality. As was already mentioned, an insistence of human freedom is at the center of Sartre's philosophy. His theory of freedom is based on his analysis of the four itself. As was explained earlier, all consciousness is consciousness of something. What is this consciousness about? It is about being as it appears. It might look as if consciousness must be other than being. Consciousness then must be understood as something which rises through a negation of being in itself. Sartre further elaborates his ideas of being in itself in Being and Nothingness. Being in itself is dense, massive, and full. The in itself harbors no nothingness. Consciousness is that whereby negation or nihilation is introduced. By its very nature, consciousness involves or is separated from being, though if it is asked what separates it from being, the answer can only be nothing, for there is no intervening or separating entity. Consciousness is itself not being, and its activity, according to Sartre, is a process of nihilation. When I am aware of this computer that I am keying in, I distantiate myself from it, deny that I am the computer, and I make the computer appear, stand out from its background by denying that it is anything else, by nihilating other phenomena. The being by which nothingness comes into the world is a being in which, in its own being, there is question of the nothingness of its being. The being by which nothingness comes into the world must be its own nothingness. Man is the being through whom nothingness comes into the world. The ideas presented by Sartre here are confusing. He says that consciousness is said to be its own nothingness, but it is also referred to as a being, as indeed it must be if it is to be described as exercising the activity attributed to it. For a moment, let us assume that being in itself is what Sartre says that it is, and if being is made to appear as the object of consciousness, consciousness of being must presumably involve the separation of which he speaks, and in this sense not being. It is rather confusing for the kind of language that he employs, and hence we should try to examine the premises which lead to its employment. How does consciousness arise? It is difficult to see how being in itself, if it is as Sartre describes it, could give rise to anything at all, even to its own negation. It is equally difficult, if not more so, to see how consciousness could originate itself. As for the ego subject, this arises, as we have seen, not on the level of pre-reflexive consciousness, but on that of reflexive consciousness. It comes into being through the reflection of consciousness on itself, and it is thus made to appear as object. In this case, there is no transcendental ego which could originate consciousness. However, that consciousness has arisen is an indubitable fact, and Sartre depicts it as rising through the occurrence of a fissure or rupture in being, resulting in the distinction which is essential to consciousness. However, Sartre does not offer any really clear account of the origin of consciousness. Existence and essence. As was already mentioned, Sartre famously pronounced existence precedes essence in his 1946 essay titled Existentialism is a Humanism. In fact, he meant it as a definition of existentialism. He also feels that every existentialist thought could be summarized in this brief statement. He was catering to the already existing popularity of existentialism all over Europe. Though many later philosophers disagreed with him on this definition of existentialism, What he really claims is that for human beings, our existence precedes our essence. The claim has to be understood in perspective, and for that, one has to deal with what he means by essence. Essence is what is necessary. The essence of something is whatever makes it what it is. What is essential for fish curry is what makes a fish curry. If fish is the most essential ingredient of fish curry, then fish gives fish curry its essence. So, by saying that existence precedes essence, Sartre means that human beings exist before they really are anything. Human beings are born and are already conscious of their lives. However, according to Sartre, the most crucial and the most necessary ingredient which defines what a human being is nothing. There is no essential human nature since there is nothing a human is meant to do. Hence, a human literally starts as nothing. All of Sartre's thought has to be understood from this standpoint. The other consequence of the existence precedes essence is that human beings are free to create what they will become. It does not just mean that one can choose who one wants to be. This freedom to make oneself and one's acting on this freedom are what makes one. Sartre also famously proclaimed that a human being is freedom. He rejects the notion that this construction is a way of secretly acknowledging a human nature he claims does not exist. What he really means is that freedom is a nature so far as it is only an empty nature waiting to be filled in. It is almost like an empty vessel one has to fill. The empty vessel is there, but it exists only to be filled in with something else. If existence precedes essence, we are not only free to create ourselves. We are also free of any inherent built-in baggage. Because we are nothing, nothing is compelling us or prejudicing our choices or our actions. We are given with several possibilities to choose from. This kind of a freedom of possibilities should not be taken lightly according to Sartre. He feels that freedom carries great weight and that freedom is not just about leading a carefree life. What he really proposes is that with freedom, human beings also get a responsibility. For saying this, he could be termed as a moralist, unlike many of his contemporary existentialists. However, in proposing the responsible freedom, he is not turning out to be a completely nihilist or an anarchist philosopher, as he is usually made out to be. Individual and freedom. Sartre's style of philosophical writing is deep, complex, and highly detailed. A problem that the readers always faced was that he is not clear enough. But because his concept of philosophy is that it should be relevant to everyone, Sartre uses several powerful language devices like short, powerful, and highly suggestive sentences. Hence, his second important comment, human beings are condemned to be free, has to be understood by going into the rhetorical aspects of his language. The statement would sound like freedom is something bad. Think of a man coming out of a jail after many years of stay. No one will tell him that he is condemned to be free. Sartre is also not suggesting that God has condemned human beings to be free. What he means, however, is that being free is a fundamental part of the human condition and that we cannot escape our freedom. Unlike many of his predecessors like Nietzsche and contemporaries like Camus, Sartre calls this an optimistic philosophy, an optimism about where we can go from where we start. This discussion is about the human condition, which he admits can look pretty bleak at times. Hence, The freedom that Sartre dooms humans to have has to be understood with respect to the responsibility. Hence, his philosophy really is that human beings are totally free and totally responsible. Responsibility itself has two elements. If you are responsible for something, you ideally have some kind of power or control over the outcome. Being responsible for something suggests that it matters somehow that something is at stake. Real responsibility involves things you care about in one way or another. In the case of freedom, the responsibility you bear is, in a very real sense, for everything you care about. In a nutshell, the twin concepts of freedom and responsibility are inescapable, according to Sartre. In order to understand Sartre's notion of subjectivity, one has to go back to the famous saying of the French philosopher René Descartes. Descartes said, "I think, therefore I am. Cogito ergo sum." Though "I think, therefore I am" would seem like a simple statement, it might also seem like asking the question how we can be certain of anything. How would one know whether what one believes is true? Even when one is able to doubt every belief one has, one would be able to doubt one's own existence. The only thing one would not be able to doubt is the existence of a thinker or oneself who was doubting. Hence, Descartes proclaimed that one fact he could be certain of was that he existed. "I think, therefore I am." He maintains that there is a separation between consciousness and the rest of the world. In this view, the human body is conceptually distinct from the human mind or consciousness. Like many other philosophers who followed Descartes, Sartre also thinks that our own consciousness is the one certainty we all start with, and that it is from this subjective viewpoint that each of us look out onto the world. But although Descartes thinks we fundamentally judge statements to be true or false by looking out from our consciousness, Sartre feels that our fundamental act is to choose how to interpret and interact with the outside world. For Sartre, the first act of consciousness is to choose. Consciousness in itself is nothing. It becomes something only as it makes these choices. This is what makes us different from all the other objects in the universe. Most objects simply are what they are. They are complete in a sense in themselves. Human beings are like rocks, objects in the world. As such, they simply are what they are. But unlike other objects, we also create what we are and what we will become. We are subjects that create what we are through the choices we make. The point is not simply that consciousness can do this, but that this is what consciousness does by its very nature. Whereas other objects like rocks and watches simply are, a consciousness is constantly creating itself by constantly choosing. We have the sole responsibility of our own choices. So each choice we make also comes with certain responsibility. As an atheist, Sartre would not accept God as the justification for our actions. But the argument about personal choice and responsibility is the same even if God did exist. Choice is still ultimately in one's hands alone. But according to Sartre, free choice ultimately creates value and meaning. If there is no principle of a God which gives value to everything, the objective value also does not exist. This also means that anything has any inherent meaning, but that does not mean that life has no value and meaning at all. It is just that every meaning and value is a human meaning or a human value. And because human beings have no human nature and no inherent values or meaning, we do attempt constantly to create those human meanings and values. This sort of an understanding of value is clearly optimistic, and this is why Sartre's philosophy is considered not a complete pessimistic one. Let us summarize the major ideas in this session. This unit was dedicated to the existentialist philosophy of Jean-Paul Sartre, the French novelist, thinker, and philosopher. We attempted to understand the basic philosophical ideas like existence, essence, consciousness, and individual freedom. We also looked at how Sartre's philosophy is not a pessimistic one, even though all through his life he was an atheist. Through this unit, we also tried to understand how Sartre made some of his ideas very popular. Please make an attempt to answer the questions given here. Explain the influence of Descartes on Sartre. What is essence, and why is it that existence is more important than essence according to Sartre? Why does Sartre say that human beings are condemned to be free? What is the difference between the in itself and the for itself? Why is freedom associated with responsibility according to Sartre? What is the notion of subjectivity and consciousness in Sartre's existential philosophy? What is the role of personal choice in Sartre's philosophy? Why does Sartre not accept God as the justification for our actions? Now, you can refer the books listed here for further understanding. Foucault and Historical Reason, Toward an Existentialist Theory of History by Thomas R. Flynn. University of Chicago Press, Chicago and London, 1997. The Existentialism of Jean-Paul Sartre by Jonathan Weber. Routledge, London and New York, 2009. A History of Philosophy, Volume 9. Modern Philosophy, From the French Revolution to Sartre, Camus and Lévi-Strauss by Frederick S. J. Copleston, Image Books and Doubleday, New York, 1977. Hope that you have enjoyed this session. Thank you for watching this program.